Okay, the first thing we will start today is discordant sexual development. Discordant sexual development. At first, when the sex of the baby is determined, the sex of the baby is determined at the moment of fertilization. At fertilization, XX, this will be a female, XY, this will be a male. And you can see that the nature is going towards that any baby will be a female. So having Y chromosome, this will be an exception. So there will be changes, there will be deviation. So this baby will go in the pathway to be a male, not a female. So what will make the changes? Presence of Y chromosome. Not all Y chromosome is important. We care for certain segments in Y chromosome. It's called SRY gene. This SRY gene, which will give the order to the gonads to become testes instead of ovaries. Without Y chromosome, no SRY gene is present. The developing gonads will become ovaries. We know that in the first 6 weeks of life. We know that in the first 6 weeks of life, it's a period of indifferent gonads. So the gonads yet not formed to be testes, not formed to be ovaries, still indifferent. That only coelomic epithelium and the germ cells came from the ulc sac and sex cords. We don't know yet if this is testes or this will be ovary. Okay. So the first point, SRY gene, present or not? What is the aim of SRY gene? It will give the order to the developing gonads to be testes instead of being ovaries. Okay, next step. The testes will form testosterone and will form also anti-Müllerian hormone. Testosterone will make the shape of external genitalia to be masculine instead of feminine. Anti-Müllerian hormone will change the genital tubules. We have two tubules. We have Müllerian duct and we have Wolffian duct. Anti-Müllerian hormone will suppress the Müllerian duct. Again, develop in male. But until 6 weeks, it's still in different gonads. Okay, but from the moment of fertilization, we can know if this will develop into male or female.
طب لو في اكسوجينس يعني هرمونز
المستفكشن it will come. Okay. So again at fertilization, so this will be XX or XY. At this point, this baby is female or this baby is male. Okay, if Y chromosome is present, so SRY gene, it's the sex determining gene, will give order to the developing gonads to be either testes or ovaries. If testes are formed, there will be two hormones, AMH, and there will be testosterone. Testosterone will change the shape of genitalia to be feminine. And the AMH will suppress Müllerian duct. So Wolffian duct will develop to lead to male internal structures. These sexual organs, they are under effect of testosterone. Testosterone will go to these organs and will be converted into to be dihydrotestosterone. If this conversion is defective, testosterone to the active form, dihydrotestosterone, if this didn't occur, this genitalia will be ambiguous. Also, if during the development of a female baby, if the mother received androgen, okay, external source of androgen, this female baby will suffer. She will be virilized or masculinized. So what is the role of SRY gene? The gonads will become cysts or ovaries. AMH, it suppresses Mullerian duct, so Wolffian duct will develop, so this will be male baby. Androgens, they act on the genital structures, so they will be male structures. At first, female pseudo hermaphrodite, 46XX. So in this baby, X chromosome from the mother, X chromosome from the father. So this is female. So why this is abnormal? Because the mother received androgen. So this female, the genitalia will be exposed to external androgen. So you will find the genitalia is ambiguous. You will find the clitoris is enlarged. You will find that the labia will fuse to be like scrotum. So at the moment of delivery, you can't know if this is female or male. And the shape is more towards male. This occurs as in congenital adrenal hyperplasia. What occurs in congenital adrenal hyperplasia? We have an enzyme. Is called 21-hydroxylase enzyme. In the adrenal cortex, three hormones are formed: androgen, cortisone, aldosterone. 21-hydroxylase is important for formation of cortisone, aldosterone, but not for androgen. It's not important for androgen. If these female babies are born with enzymatic deficiency, they lack 21-hydroxylase enzyme. So there will be deficiency in cortisone, deficiency in aldosterone. So there will be reflex feedback mechanism to increase adrenocorticotropic hormone. So adrenocorticotropic hormone will increase. Adrenocorticotropic hormone will try to compensate by increasing manufacture of the androgen and the cortisone. But this is hopeless because this baby has enzymatic deficiency. So we can't compensate. So the increased senses will go in the direction of increased androgen. So this female baby will have large amount of androgen. So cortisone low, aldosterone low, androgen high. So the external genitalia will be masculine. This is an emergency situation at delivery. Why? Here the main problem is not the shape of the genitalia. The main problem here is lack of cortisone and the lack of aldosterone. This newborn can die because of electrolyte imbalance and hypoglycemia. So please, if you find the genitalia ambiguous, if you find that clitoris is large, the labia are fused to be like scrotum, this can be congenital adrenal hyperplasia. Take care, this baby can die within hours or within days from hypoglycemia and electrolyte imbalance. So you have to give cortisone. And if this syndrome is suspected while the baby is still in utero, we can give the woman cortisone. Cortisone will go to the baby. So there will be no deficiency in cortisone. So adrenocorticotropic hormone will not increase. So the genitalia will be protected. This is called congenital adrenal hyperplasia. Important exam question. What is the main enzymatic deficiency in congenital adrenal hyperplasia? The answer is 21-hydroxylase enzyme. This 21-hydroxylase enzyme, it acts upon a material called pregnenolone and 17-hydroxyprogesterone. 17-hydroxyprogesterone. When this enzyme becomes deficient, this 17-hydroxyprogesterone will accumulate in the body and will not be converted. So in the next steps, cortisone aldosterone will be formed. This will not happen. So how to diagnose congenital adrenal hyperplasia? 46XX. Genitalia ambiguous, large clitoris fused, labia-like scrotum. 21-hydroxylase enzyme deficient. 17-hydroxyprogesterone increased. This is how to diagnose congenital adrenal hyperplasia. Any other enzymes can lead to the same? Yes. 11-hydroxylase and 3-beta-hydroxysteroid dehydrogenase. Any of these three enzymes can lead to CH, the most important one, 21-hydroxylase. Is it an emergency? Yes, this baby can die from electrolyte imbalance and hypoglycemia. So how to correct? Give cortisone, check for electrolyte imbalance, and corrective surgery, corrective cosmetic surgery to amputate this large clitoris and to correct these fused labia. This is congenital adrenal hyperplasia. What is the gender? XX. So there is no Y gene. So there is no Y chromosome. So there is no SRY gene. So the gonads are ovaries. Normal. AMH is not present. So the internal structures are feminine. The problem here only in the external genitalia. So the internal structures are feminine. There is ovary, there is uterus, there is partial vagina, but the lower part of vagina will be lost because of increased androgen. Easy? Clear up to now?
Yes, sir.
This is called congenital adrenal hyperplasia. The most common enzyme deficiency here, 21-hydroxylase, 17-hydroxyprogesterone will accumulate. The internal structures are normal because there is no Y gene, there is no Y chromosome, there is no SRY gene. So only the problem in the external genitalia. The next one, male pseudo-hermaphrodite. Why I say pseudo? Because true hermaphrodite is something extremely rare. What is the meaning of true hermaphrodite? That the person has testes and ovaries in the same person. This is very rare. Male pseudo-hermaphrodite. Male, so XY. 46XY. So what is the problem? Y chromosome is present. So there is SRY gene. So there will be testes. What is the problem? The problem in the androgen. Androgen is absent or non-functioning due to enzymatic deficiency. We know that on the external genitalia, testosterone is converted into dihydrotestosterone, which is the most potent form. If this conversion didn't occur, the genitalia will be ambiguous. So the penis will be small like clitoris. The external genitalia will be separated like labia. So it's the opposite side of congenital adrenal hyperplasia. What is the problem again? Enzymatic deficiency or androgen is normal, but the tissues are not responding. So they will continue to be like female structures. This is called androgen insensitivity syndrome. Androgen insensitivity syndrome. What is the problem in androgen insensitivity syndrome? This is male 46XY, but the receptors are not functioning. So the androgen will not change the shape of the external genitalia. So the nature will take its place. These external structures will be feminine. So at delivery, we will say this is a female because we can see external genitalia of a female. And this baby will grow like females because the external appearance is like females. And even in this patient, this excess amount of androgen is converted into estrogen. This estrogen will give the patient the shape of the female. So there will be breast. So breast without having androgenic hair. This is 46XY, but the appearance like female, not only female, this is beautiful female. Why? There is good breast. Came from where? Androgen is converted to estrogen. So why the genitalia like female? Androgen response is not present. That's why the genitalia will be feminine and there will be breasts. Notice male pseudohermaphrodite or androgen insensitivity syndrome, the internal genitalia, the internal gonads, this is testes. But the external appearance, feminine. Why? No androgen, no response to androgen, no receptors. So the external genitalia are feminine. What I explained now is complete androgen insensitivity syndrome. There is also partial androgen sensitivity. So there is mild decrease in the androgen, or there is the receptors are have moderate function. It will give various clinical pictures. Various. How various? Which is incomplete or partial androgen insensitivity syndrome. You will find female with male appearance or male with female appearance. We call it hirsute female or ambiguous male. This is partial. So what will be the appearance in this person at the adulthood or at puberty? There is breast, external genitalia, feminine, but the internal organs, we have tests. At puberty, we think that this is a female, but there is internal tests. So this test can convert into cancer. That's why it needs to be removed. Okay, when to remove these tests? Once diagnosed? No, at puberty. Why? Testes is the form, or this is the source of androgen, which is converted into estrogen to give her the appearance of female. This person, as we see, she is living her life as a female. They gave her a female name. She has a male boyfriend. Even she can have intercourse. There can be dyspareunia or difficult intercourse, but she is behaving like a female. So she should continue her life as a female. Memorize very well these coming words. In part three, you can have a scenario that you are going to talk a patient whose age is 15 years old. She was diagnosed with androgen insensitivity syndrome. So you are going to tell her that you are XY and you have internal gonads, not ovaries, which must be removed to avoid converting into cancer. It's a difficult question. Doctor, XY, do you mean that I am a boy? Am I a male? You will tell her, no, we can't say this. Being male or female, it doesn't depend only upon your genes and your chromosomes. No, it depends also upon how you behave with yourself and how we behave with you. This also determines, are you male or female? So we can say some females are XY, like you. You are a female, but XY. And don't tell her you have tests. No, tell her you have gonads. These gonads need to be removed. Why? They can turn into cancer. But doctor, I have dyspareunia. They told me that my vagina is short. Okay, we can do corrective surgery. We can do vaginoplasty. So she can continue her life as a female, as she is used to since birth. This is androgen insensitivity syndrome. And I have a picture. You will find some beautiful females. These are XY females. Clear? Memorize well the discussion that will occur between you and the patient. So now you memorize, you already memorize now what is androgen insensitivity syndrome. This discussion needs to be memorized. Easy up till now?
Easy.
Easy?
Easy. Dr. Osama?
Yes.
يعني what is the difference in case of incomplete يعني بيبقى برضو deficient في ال androgen receptor ولا
yes partial problem so this will be hirsute female or male with ambiguous genitalia. Notice something, the key word in androgen insensitivity syndrome that there is no or scanty, very few or absent androgenic hair. This word came in the exam before, scanty, scanty pubic hair. This is androgen insensitivity. Scanty, scanty means very, very few, near to be absent. This is androgen insensitivity syndrome. Look. If there is uterus or not, uterus needs absence of AMH, so absence of Y chromosome. If there is Y chromosome, there will be AMH, so there will be no uterus. In this person, there is Y chromosome, so there is AMH. So this patient has no uterus, so she can't be fertile. This is another sad news you are going to tell her, that she has no uterus. Doctor, how I can become pregnant? The only way is adoption. Because she has no uterus, she has no ovaries. The only way is adoption. Maybe in the future, the surgery of uterine transplantation will increase, so she may have a chance of having uterus in the future, but we can't say this up till now. But in the future, this can be one of the solutions. So this patient with androgen insensitivity, she is sterile. Sterile. She has tests and she has no uterus. He went to remove the gonads here at puberty. Why? To avoid becoming cancer. After removing the testes, there will be no testosterone, so estrogen also will decrease, so we need hormone replacement therapy to avoid complications of menopausal symptoms. Turner syndrome, 45XO. What do you mean? There is absent X chromosome. So there will be malformed gonads. The ovaries will be streak. There is no Y chromosome, so they will be ovaries, but they are streak. So this woman can be infertile or can be subfertile. Some women have good ovarian function, so they can have ovulation, they can have cycle, and they can get pregnancy. These patients with malformed gonads, due to deficiency of one X chromosome, okay, they suffer from a syndrome. So there will be coarctation of aorta, hypertension, lucid ears, okay, cubitus vulgaris, it's abnormality in the elbow. It's a syndrome called Turner syndrome. These patients with Turner syndrome, with these malformed gonads, also she can develop a type of ovarian cancers, which like malformed gonads, it's called dysgerminoma. Dysgerminoma. It can occur in cases with Turner syndrome and any case with malformed gonads. This is Turner syndrome. Some cases with Turner syndrome can be mixed or can be mosaic. How mosaic? Some cells containing XX, some cells containing XO. That's why some of them can be fertile. Swire syndrome. Swire syndrome is absent SRY gene. And it's good that the two words, they have similar letters, SRY and the Swire. So there is no SRY gene. So the gonads now don't know, will I be testis or will I be ovaries? I don't know. So they will be streak gonads in this SRY gene absence. So Y chromosome is present, but it doesn't have SRY gene in this syndrome. So it's 46XY, but Y chromosome here has abnormality. There is no SRY gene. So the gonads, will I be ovaries or will I be testes? I don't know. I will be streak gonads. Take care, streak gonads. They are at risk of becoming cancer in the future. So once diagnosed, we will remove them because they are streak. They are not functioning and can turn into cancer. So once diagnosed, they will be removed. True hermaphrodite is very rare to have XX and XY in the same person. So you can find one ovary and one testis, or two ovaries and two testis. This is extremely rare to have this true hermaphrodite. Okay, this one will have the general appearance of female or male according to which one is predominant. And you may find both in the same time. How? There can be penis and the vagina in the same person. So both of them can be functioning, or one of them can be functioning more than the other. So it will be more towards male or more towards female. There. Embryonic testicular regression. So these persons will have tests, but non-functioning tests or poorly functioning tests, like cases with Klinefelter syndrome. There is additional X chromosome. So the tests will be underactive. That's why these patients are subfertile or infertile. And we know that Klinefelter syndrome is the commonest chromosomal abnormality in patients with azoospermia. So exam question, a patient with azoospermia, has chromosomal abnormality. What is the commonest chromosomal abnormality here? Klinefelter syndrome, followed by Y microdeletion. Another syndrome called Mullerian agenesis. You can finish Mullerian agenesis in one word. Mullerian agenesis is a woman with congenital anomaly. What is the congenital anomaly? Absent Mullerian duct. So any structure depending upon Mullerian duct will be absent. In the embryology, there are two Mullerian ducts. They fuse in the midline. So there will be here the uterus, and here the fallopian tubes, and cervix, and upper part of vagina. These are the structures which need the Mullerian duct. If there is no Mullerian duct, Mullerian agenesis, or Müller-Rotenski-Kostner-Hauser syndrome, there will be no fallopian tube, no uterus, no cervix, no upper part of vagina. What about the ovary? It doesn't need Mullerian duct. Okay, so ovary is present normally. So this is a woman with congenital anomaly. So she is normal XX female, but Mullerian duct is absent. So these structures are not present. So she is a female with congenital anomaly. What about the breast? Will form it. No problem. What about the androgenic hair? Normal. Estrogen is converted into androgen, giving pubic hair. Normal. But androgen insensitivity, remember the Bart 3 scenario I told you. You will tell her you have XY, but you are a female. Doctor, can I get pregnant? I am sorry, no, because you have no uterus. You don't have ovary. You have gonads, which need to be removed. When? At age of puberty. Why not early? Because they supply you with hormones. Breast is present normally. Androgenic hair absent. So, what is the main hormone here? Estrogen is present normally. But here, we have androgen converted to estrogen. But here, mainly androgen, but not functioning because the receptors are not functioning well. So the gonads, here XY tests, here XX ovary. Uterus, absent in both of them. Why? Because this one already. But don't say this to the patient. She is a male. She has XY. That's why no uterus is present. But this one, she is a female with anomaly. So there is no uterus. Axillary and pubic hair. Here present normally because the receptors are functioning. And androgen insensitivity not present. Easy up till now? Easy up to now.
Dr. Osama.
Yes.
Dr. Osama. Regarding Seward's syndrome, the X chromosome, this should will be developed as a complete female but lacks gonads. And when we remove the gonads, she will receive hormone replacement therapy.
Look, the risk of cancer transformation in Swire syndrome is very high. That's why we can't wait until puberty. You have to remove the gonads once diagnosed. The risk even is higher than androgen insensitivity, the risk of cancer. That's why in androgen insensitivity, we can wait until puberty, then they can be removed. Why there is risk of cancer transformation in androgen insensitivity? Because in this situation, the tests are present intra-abdominal, or they can be present as femoral or inguinal hernia, but anyway, not inside the scrotum, as should be. That's why the heat can lead to cancer. In Swire syndrome, the risk of cancer is higher. Why? There are three gonads, abnormal gonads. Okay?
after removal, both of them will receive the hormone replacement estrogen, صح?
Look, in case with androgen insensitivity, she is a female and will continue her life as a female. So you will give her HRT as a female, like cases with premature ovarian insufficiency. Okay, in Swyer syndrome, let's see. XY patient absent tests results in lack of SRY gene or other test determining factor on Y chromosome. These three gonads will fail to produce androgen or image. Patient appear normal prepubertal female and have normal Mullerian system. So she needs also estrogen. She will continue her life also as a female after gonadectomy.
And she has yani complete vagina, who you like normal Mullerian system. Okay.
Okay.
Okay, yes.
Doctor, there is absent pubic hair in Swyer syndrome. Completely absent. Yes?
This is a description.
Yes.
Of Swyer syndrome.
Okay.
The problem is absence of SRY gene, so there is no tests. No tests, so no androgen. So no androgen.
So we can differentiate it from androgen insensitivity syndrome by scanty.
Notice.
No, by present vagina.
Female. Notice. Female. Female, normal female has androgenic hair. Okay, the pubic hair is androgen dependent. It's normal to be present, except in androgen insensitivity syndrome, because the receptors are not responding. So the case in which there is no androgenic hair at all, it's the case of androgen insensitivity syndrome. Why? The receptors are not responding. Even in normal female, there is some androgen, which will lead to androgenic hair, like the pubic hair. So but even...
Both of them XY, okay?
Swyer is XY. And also and androgen insensitivity, she is XY.
The difference between androgen sensitivity and Swyer syndrome is the Swyer has a uterus and androgen insensitivity has no uterus. So this is the only difference.
No, not the only. Sorry, you can't say this. The other differences, the hair. Case with androgen insensitivity syndrome, she has no androgenic hair. Why? Because the receptors are not functioning. Although there is high androgen, but not responding.
And this has no SRY. There's no SRY gene.
Look, normal female has androgenic hair.
By congenital adrenal, yes, from the adrenal, yes.
Even normal female has androgenic hair. Even any female in the world has some androgen. This androgen will lead to androgenic hair, like the pubic hair, the axillary hair. But in these cases with androgen insensitivity, there is no androgenic hair. The receptors are not responding. There is no any other problem of this which has abnormality in the androgenic receptors.
So in Swyer, there is pubic hair from adrenal source, sir? Huh?
Any female has androgen coming from the adrenal source.
Yes. Okay.
Also, androgen can come from the peripheral conversion from estrogen into androgen. It's another source. So androgens can be formed from the ovary and they can be formed from the adrenal, except diethylsulfate. Diethylsulfate is exclusive coming from the adrenal 100%. That's why if in the exam you suspect an androgen producing cancer, look at diethylsulfate. If diethylsulfate is high, this is exclusive adrenal in origin. So this is adrenal tumor, not ovarian tumor. If Dahia sulfate is normal, it's ovarian tumor. Okay, this table for your knowledge. So what are the embryological structures and what will be the fate in female? What will be the fate in male? The genital ridge will form ovary and testes. Germ cells will be oocytes or spermatozoa. Sex cord, granulosa and seminiferous tubules. Gubernaculum will become round ligament of uterus in females. Important, it came before in the exam. What is the fate of gubernaculum in female? It will be the round ligament of ovary and round ligament of uterus. Mesonephric tubules, mesonephric duct, it will become Gartner duct. Mesonephric tubule, it will be embryological remnant. You can find them inside the broad ligament, epoferon and parafron. Paramesonephric duct, which is a Mullerian, and this will be absent in Mullerian agenesis. Urogenital sinus, genital tubercle, it will be clitoris and penis. Urogenital fold and the swelling. The fold is medial, the swelling is lateral. The fold will be labia minora, the swelling will be labia majora. That's why if there is androgen, the labia majora will be enlarged and diffused to be like scrotum under effect of androgen. And this needs receptors. If not present, it will be androgen insensitivity. Don't worry. In the coming slides, there will be again repeating and other forms of summarizing the previous syndromes. Macon-Albright syndrome, it's one of the causes of precocious puberty in which the hypothalamus and the pituitary will act early. We know that the age of puberty is 8 years in female and 9 years in male. So less than 8 in female is precocious, less than 9 in male is precocious puberty. This can occur in Macon-Albright, that the hypothalamus is acting early, producing GnRH, so it will be precocious puberty. Very characteristic word in Macon-Albright syndrome, these caffeole patches. In the exam, caffeole patches equal Macon-Albright. Caffeole patches. Turner syndrome, which is 45XO. As we see with the neck, lucid hair and the lucid ear. Okay, cubitus vulgaris, coarctation of aorta, streak gonads, small ovaries, fibrotic ovaries. They can be non-functioning or partially functioning. This woman needs hormone replacement therapy because she has low amount of estrogen. And these streak gonads producing small amount of estrogen, so feedback mechanism FSH, LH will be high. Genetic 45XO. She can have primary amenorrhea, or she can have infertility. If she is mosaic, she can have menses, but she can be infertile. Klinefelter, 47XXY. This additional X chromosome will lead to gynecomastia. The testes will be small and hypoactive, so this patient can be azoospermia. And because of these small tests, reflex FSH and LH will be high. So as you can see, Klinefelter syndrome, it has hormonal profile, like precocious puberty, like premature ovarian failure in females. So this male will have premature testicular failure. FSH high, LH high, androgen is low. Tall, why tall? due to decreased androgen. Androgen helps closure of epiphysis. If there is low androgen, the patient will be told gynecomastia, female hair distribution, developmental delay, Klinefelter syndrome, the commonest chromosomal abnormality in azoospermics. This group of beautiful females, they are 46XY. Okay, I think all of them suffered from the breaking bad news at puberty that we are sorry, you can't have children because you don't have uterus and you don't have ovaries, you have gonads, and these gonads need to be removed at puberty, and after that you will receive hormone replacement therapy. So all these XY, but they don't have androgenic hair. They have breast, came from where androgen will become estrogen. So they have breast. That's why they have estrogen. They have androgen. So FSH and LH are normal. Testosterone even very high. Why? Testosterone is not converted into the hydrotestosterone, so will accumulate. Okay, 5-alpha reductase deficiency. If there is 5-alpha reductase, testosterone will not be converted into dihydrotestosterone. That's why the manifestation will be like androgen insensitivity syndrome. Okay, it's enzymatic deficiency. So testosterone is not converted into dihydrotestosterone. So it's one of the syndromes of androgen insensitivity, that testosterone is not converted into dihydrotestosterone. Kallmann syndrome. In Kallmann syndrome, there is very characteristic word, which is anosmia. Anosmia, that the patient lost or doesn't have smelling sensation. Kallmann syndrome, it's hypothalamic syndrome in which there is no gonadotropin releasing hormone, so there is no gonadotropin, so there will be hypogonadotrophic hypogonadism. Hypogonadotrophic hypogonadism. So FSH, LH, estrogen, all of these are low. Hypogonadotrophic hypogonadism. It's hypothalamic problem and the pituitary problem. So it will be hypogonadotrophic hypogonadism. Can you tell me this hypogonadotrophic hypogonadism? This is which? WHO, anovulatory disorder, hypogonadotrophic hypogonadism.
Group one.
How to treat group one? Gonadotrophins or intermittent or pulsatile GnRH, but don't say chromaffine. Not useful here. The pituitary is not functioning. There is abnormal embryology of the pituitary here. That's why it will not form any FSH or LH. So you will give GN from outside. So Kallmann syndrome, it's a hypogonadotrophic hypogonadism. So, FSH, LH, estrogen, all are low. Characteristic word, anosmia, no smelling sensation. To summarize, problems with XX. This is a female, but the mother received androgen. So the genitalia will be ambiguous. Or the baby or the fetus itself, it has increased androgen. Congenital adrenal hyperplasia. How to diagnose? Ambiguous genitalia, XX, this is the genomic structure, and 17-hydroxyprogesterone increased, 21-hydroxylase enzyme deficient, aldosterone low, cortisol low, androgen high, life-threatening situation at puberty. So give cortisone and correct any electrolyte imbalance. Problems with XY, Swire syndrome. As we said, there is streak gonads. That's why they can turn into cancer. In 20% of cases, they can turn into cancer. That's why should be removed once diagnosed. 5-alpha reductase. There is absent uterus, primary amenorrhea, plus virilization. Let me confirm this word at first. Androgen insensitivity, it can be complete, it can be partial. Complete androgen insensitivity, like the picture that we saw here. They have complete androgen insensitivity. Notice that cases with complete androgen insensitivity, complete, can they develop hirsutism? Can you tell me? Can this woman suffer from hirsutism any time in her life?
No.
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 Never.
No.
No.
She has no receptors for androgen. That's why she never suffered from hirsutism. So, the most important syndromes. The most important syndromes. Congenital adrenal hyperplasia. How to memorize? Remember the scenario of the newborn, which has large clitoris, fused labia. This baby can suffer from electrolyte imbalance and hypoglycemia. Why that? The genitalia are ambiguous? Excess androgen. Why? Congenital adrenal hyperplasia. Very important, androgen insensitivity. Remember this picture and remember the Part 3 MRSOG exam about breaking bad news to a woman with androgen insensitivity syndrome. You will tell her you have XY, you have gonads, which need to be removed, you are sterile. Some very bad news you are going to say. And Mullerian agenesis. This is a female with absent Mullerian duct. So ovary is present, but any structure from Mullerian duct is absent. Clear?
Dr. Osama. Regarding congenital
congenital
hyperplasia. Oh, yeah, crazy. There are some types of non-functional types. دي هي الحاجات اللي مش due to 21 hydroxylase.
بيسموها ايه؟
non-salt losing. يعني دي هي برضو هي ال 11
so aldosterone is present. So aldosterone is present. Salt losing came from defective aldosterone. Aldosterone leads to salt water retention. So if there is decreased aldosterone, there will be electrolyte and water loss. And this is the classic. The classic scenario, there is less cortisol or absent cortisol, and there is low or absent aldosterone. That's why they lose electrolytes. So they can die from electrolyte imbalance. And this occurs with 21 hydroxylase deficiency. There will be some variation. If this is 11 hydroxylase deficiency or beta steroid hydroxylase deficiency, there will be some variations, but the most important one, which is the classic one, 21 hydroxylase deficiency.
Another question, cosmetic correction in ambiguous genitalia, at what age? Yani before 2 years or at what age? Secondly, how we diagnose antenatally, depending on family history? Yani?
Yes, maybe due to history, maybe by ultrasound. Let's say that we did chorionic villus sampling, suspecting down, okay? And we know that this is XX. And during ultrasound, we find large penis. Came from where? this can be congenital adrenal hyperplasia. We can give the woman cortisone to suppress adrenocorticotropic hormone in the baby. Okay.
طب cosmetic correction بتبقى أكيد at young age.
In which scenario?
In congenital في ambiguous genitalia should be corrected at what age?
Look, the most important problem here is what is life saving, to prevent electrolyte imbalance and to prevent hypoglycemia because of defective cortisone. Correction can be done later. It's not urgent at all. The most important is what is life saving.
Okay.
Dr. Osama, assalamu alaikum.
Yes. Wa alaikum salam.
Study regarding the McQueen-Pride syndrome.
Yes.
Is a central precocious puberty.
Yes.
Is it a central or a preferent? Because it is written also in the slide, it is GnRH independent. So that means it's a preferent syndrome, right?
Look,
precocious.
Okay, look, in McQueen-Albright, there will be precocious production of gonadotropin-releasing hormone, so the hypothalamus will act early. The hypothalamus will act early, so it will produce GnRH. So it will lead to early stimulation of the ovaries and early stimulation of the testes in male.
But it is written gonadotropin independent. What does that mean?
Gonadotropin independent. So it's not a problem of gonadotropins. It's a problem of gonadotropin releasing hormone.
It isn't so, ovarian cyst. It is ovarian cyst secreting estrogen.
No. McQueen-Albright is complete precocious puberty. That this child can be fertile. So there is ovulation in this female. Not only appearance, not only external appearance, no. Okay, of course. Each one of these syndromes can be a complete topic, but you will not be asked about these details in the exam. Okay, we are having only one slide about each one of them.
The McQueen-Albright syndrome be treated by aromatase inhibitor or
I don't know.
Yes, Dr. Osama. The treatment, the drug of choice for treatment letrozole, aromatase inhibitor. Yes.
Okay.
Because that's why I ask you, because it is a peripheral. You will give the aromatase enzyme inhibitor, estrogen receptor modulator. Okay. So it is a peripheral precocious puberty.
That's why
central peripheral.
Okay. Your role in the treatment here is to prevent the sequence of events. You can't correct the cause, but it's not accepted to have a girl at seven years old or even early with enlarged breast and the feminine appearance. That's why you are treating the symptoms. You are treating the symptoms, not preventing the problem. Okay. How to treat the questions about acid-base balance and about ABG. In the ABG, we want to know if this is acidosis or alkalosis. So the first thing, you will look at the pH. Normal pH, 735 to 745. Less than this, acidosis. Higher than this, alkalosis. So the first thing you have to do is this ABG, acidosis or alkalosis. Okay, let's say that it was 7.2. So now I have 50% of the diagnosis. This is acidosis. Second question, is it Is it metabolic or respiratory? So I will look at the carbon dioxide and I will look at the HCO3 to know who is the criminal that lead to this acidosis. Okay, how carbon dioxide can be the criminal? Carbon dioxide is an acid. So if there is acidosis and the carbon dioxide is increased, this is a criminal. It's a respiratory. HCO3 is an alkaline and it's metabolic. If there is acidosis and the HCO3 is decreased, so this is metabolic acidosis. So acidosis can occur in one of two scenarios. Excess carbon dioxide, it will be respiratory, or decreased bicarb, it will be metabolic. How to know? Look at carbon dioxide, look at HCO3. If carbon dioxide increased, respiratory acidosis. If bicarb reduced, metabolic acidosis. What if the pH is increased, 7.5? So there is alkalosis. Okay, who is the criminal? Carbon dioxide, which is an acid, can be the criminal if it's reduced. Bicarb, which is an alkali, can be the criminal if increased. In alkalosis, and bicarb increased, finished, it's metabolic. If carbon dioxide is reduced, finished, it's respiratory. So, number one, look at the pH. Is it acidosis or alkalosis? Now you have 50% of the diagnosis. Number two, metabolic or respiratory? Look at the bicarb and look at the carbon dioxide to see which one of them is synchronous with the abnormal pH. So if I have the pH acidotic and the carbon dioxide normal or reduced, it's not respiratory problem, not respiratory. This is not the criminal. Okay, what about oxygen saturation? It can be normal or it can be hypoxia. Hypoxia can occur if there is respiratory failure. Something else can help you to know if there is base, if it's metabolic or not, looking at the base deficit. Base deficit, normal base deficit from minus 2 to plus 2. So minus 2, minus 1, 0, plus 1, plus 2. This is normal base deficit. Base deficit will be decreased, its base, so alkaline. So base deficit will be decreased in acidosis and increased in alkalosis. So if you have abnormal pH and the base deficit normal, it's a respiratory problem. What if base deficit decreased? It's metabolic acidosis. Base deficit increased, metabolic alkalosis. Again?
Please, repeat Dr. again. Just this part again, base deficit. But.
Okay, again. There is no need to memorize any form like Rome. I don't care for this. I understand it. How? Number one, look at the pH level. pH decreased, acidosis. Increased alkalosis. Number two, look at the carbon dioxide and look at the bicarb to know which one of them is the criminal. You have to know the criteria of each one. Carbon dioxide, of course, this is a gas, so it's respiratory. And we deal with carbon dioxide as an acid. Bicarb, it's not a gas, it's metabolic. And it's alkaline. So it's metabolic and alkaline. So will increase in metabolic alkalosis, will decrease in metabolic acidosis. Carbon dioxide, respiratory acid, so will increase in respiratory acidosis and will decrease in respiratory alkalosis. So look at the pH to know if this is acidosis or alkalosis, and look at bicarb and the carbon dioxide to know which one of them is the criminal. Base deficit can help you, because base deficit from minus 2 to plus 2, if higher than this, it's metabolic alkalosis. Less than this, metabolic acidosis. So it's changed or it's abnormal if there is metabolic problem. In the respiratory problem, base deficit will be normal from minus 2 to plus 2. Easy?
What about compensators?
Okay. When there is respiratory acidosis, the kidney will try to compensate by inducing some alkalosis. How? It will retain bicarb. The excretion of bicarb will be reduced. So it will try to increase the alkaline to compensate, trying to correct the pH. Let's see what happens during pregnancy. During pregnancy, pregnant women, they have some dyspnea. That's why there is tachypnea and hyperemia. By this tachypnea, the woman is removing what from her body? With this repeated deep expiration, removing carbon dioxide. So carbon dioxide in the body will be low or high?
Low.
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 Carbon dioxide is an acid or an alkali?
Acid.
So when it becomes low, what will occur in the body?
Alkalosis.
Alkalosis. Is it respiratory or metabolic?
Respiratory.
So pregnancy is a state of respiratory alkalosis, mild respiratory alkalosis. You will not find severe changes in pH, no. Just it will be towards 7.45. So 7.45, 7.44, it's mild respiratory alkalosis. Okay? So pregnancy is a state of respiratory alkalosis. The same scenario, what occurs in pregnant women, the same like what occurs in women living on high mountains. There will be dyspnea, tachypnea, hyperemia, the same. Respiratory alkalosis. Cases with DKA, please mute mics. Cases with DKA, there will be accumulation of ketone bodies in the body. Ketone bodies are acidic and they are metabolic. That's why in DKA there is metabolic acidosis. So what will occur in the pH? Low or high?
Low.
Low. You are right. This is acidosis. What about bicarb? We want acidosis and it's metabolic.
It will be increased.
It will be
decreased.
Metabolic acidosis. If bicarb is increased, it will be metabolic acidosis. Metabolic alkalosis. So bicarb will be low. There is tachypnea. That's why carbon dioxide is washed. Carbon dioxide will be low because there is tachypnea in DKA. So there will be some respiratory alkalosis as a trial to compensate. The body is trying to compensate that there is a metabolic problem. We will try to correct through the lung to expirate a larger amount of carbon dioxide.
Dr. Sama, you said that if the base deficit is increased, so it means acidosis?
No. Base deficit will increase in alkalosis and will decrease in acidosis. So if it's minus 3, minus 4, this is metabolic acidosis. plus 3, plus 4, it's metabolic alkalosis.
Ah, okay.
So it goes with the pH, isn't it, Dr. Sama?
Hmm?
Actually, we don't know what is base deficit. To be
very not important. True. No details needed. We don't want to be experts. We want to pass the exam.
Fair enough. But what I can see, if the acidosis is there, meaning to say that if the pH is low, the base deficit is low. When the acidosis is high, pH is high, so the base deficit is high. So it goes with the pH.
Look, actually, I don't need to memorize any form that something synchronous with something. I take it by understanding. Number one, look at the pH. Number two, you know that carbon dioxide is a respiratory acid. Bicarb is a metabolic alkali. Now I can make any form you want by understanding. Hypoxia will occur if there is a respiratory failure. Base deficit. Increased in alkalosis, decreased in acidosis. If you want to say Rome, okay, if you want to say something synchronous with something, okay, but I take it by understanding.
Very good. We have understood everything. Just the last thing, inshallah. What is the difference between PO2 and O2?
CO2 and O2?
No. You have written here PO2, which is 80 to 100, and O2. Isn't this the same thing?
This one is called oxygen pressure, this one oxygen saturation. If this is low, this is hypoxia. If this is normal, there is no respiratory failure.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Doctor, we need to memorize values in pregnancy.
Look, they are not difficult. Why? Normal pH, we all know it. 7.35 to 7.45. 35 and 45, this is the number of carbon dioxide. So already you know it. Just memorize bicarb, 22-26. 22-26. The other numbers we know, what is the oxygen pressure, base deficit, very easy, minus 2 to plus 2. So even in this question, if it didn't give you the normal values, it's easy to be known. Okay.
The same.
Okay. What is mixed? Like what? In mixed, you will find that pH can be normal. What do you mean? There is some respiratory acidosis compensated by some metabolic alkalosis. So pH will be near normal. Why this is present? The body is trying to compensate. So some metabolic acidosis needs some respiratory alkalosis. So we have two systems, respiratory system and the metabolic system. If there is a problem in the respiratory system, the metabolic system will try to correct. If there is respiratory acidosis, we need metabolic alkalosis. So the target and the net result, pH will be towards normal. It will be towards normal. This is our target. So mixed, example for mixed, you will find that pH, it equals 7.4. It's normal, but by carbon dioxide will be high, and bicarb will be low. We have a respiratory problem, compensated by metabolic problem, so pH is normal. This is mixed problem. So being normal pH doesn't mean 100% that there is no problem. No, there can be a problem, but compensated. These are lists for respiratory acidosis. In respiratory acidosis, what do you think about carbon dioxide? Increased or decreased? increased because it's respiratory acid. Because of chest deformity, the patient is unable to breathe. Okay, lung disease, sedatives, so there is no good breathing, so carbon dioxide will accumulate, and obesity. Lactic acidosis can occur with prolonged exercise. It's metabolic acidosis. Lack of oxygen, so the tissue will act anaerobic, will produce lactic acid. Certain medications like salicylate, hypoglycemia, so we will act on the fat, leading to ketone bodies, acidosis. Alcoholism, seizures, liver failure, cancer, renal disease, severe dehydration, and poisoning. Alkalosis can be respiratory. Respiratory, so we did excess removal of carbon dioxide, like lack of oxygen, so there will be tachypnea. So carbon dioxide will be removed. Tachypnea, high altitude, pregnancy itself, fever, there will be tachypnea, lung disease, liver disease, salicylate poisoning. Questions? Questions?
Dr. Osama, regarding the mixed picture. So how we will know that this is the mixed, it is respiratory acidosis or metabolic? If the oxygen, carbon dioxide is increased and the pH is towards the alkalosis, so what we will say? That it is compensatory respiratory alkalosis or what?
You will find that pH towards normal.
Yes.
But and there is respiratory problem. There is respiratory problem. So carbon dioxide is high or low, compensated by metabolic. So by carb will be low or high.
So we will choose the compensatory metabolic alkalosis.
It's mixed. Look at the clinical scenario. For example,
okay.
This is a case of a respiratory problem. So it's compensated by metabolic. Or it's a metabolic problem. For example, it's a case of early DKA. In early DKA, you will find bicarb decreased. Carbon dioxide increased. So it's early and compensated. But after that, with progression, the compensation can fail. Because already the kidney did what she has to do and the pathology is still working. So the compensatory mechanism can fail. So the pH will change.
Okay, thank you.
So in the exam, if he gave you a scenario of normal pH, but carbon dioxide and bicarb are changed, it can be mixed problem. Okay. And the net result, pH is normal. So the kidney is excreting large amount of bicarb. This is metabolic acidosis. And the lung is retaining. The lung is excreting carbon dioxide. It's respiratory alkalosis. So this one is compensating this one. So there is balance.
Dr. Osama?
Yes.
Can I ask a question? In primary amenorrhea due to congenital adrenal hyperplasia, we do that 17-hydroxyprogesterone test. How? Please explain it to me.
Look, if you find that 17-hydroxyprogesterone is increased, this is congenital adrenal hyperplasia. Why? 17-hydroxyprogesterone, it's the substrate of 21-hydroxylase enzyme. So in the next steps, there should be cortisone, aldosterone. That's why when this enzyme is absent, 17-hydroxyprogesterone will accumulate. So if he told you in the exam, 17-hydroxyprogesterone is increased, finished. It's CH, congenital adrenal hyperplasia. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. One more question.
There is some variation in levels in pregnancy.
In what?
The level of CO2, level of HCO3.
No, just memorize these numbers and know that pregnancy is a respiratory alkalosis state. But this doesn't mean that you will find pH very high. No, it can be just towards the alkaline side, towards 7.45.
Okay.
Dr. Osama?
Yes.
What about the late onset congenital adrenal hyperplasia?
Late onset, for example, you will find that the baby is born normally. Okay, but because enzyme deficiency is not severe, and this can be manifested later, you will find hirsutism. Mm-hmm. So the genitalia are normal. They develop normally, but because it's late onset, it didn't occur since fetal life, it can be presented later on by hirsutism. But again, you will find deficiency of the enzyme, and again, 17-hydroxyprogesterone increased, but the genitalia normal because it didn't occur in the fetal life.
Mm. So still the test of a choice will be 17-hydroxyprogesterone.
Yes. It's one of the causes of hirsutism. And Here it's not life-threatening. You are talking about an adult or at least a child. Okay?
Okay.
Thank you so much.
Yes.
According to the congenital adrenal hyperplasia, it is only an ambiguous genitalia, but this female may have a menses, menstruation, and also got pregnant.
In congenital adrenal hyperplasia?
Yes.
She has uterus. Okay, and she has ovaries. Just all the problem in congenital adrenal hyperplasia that there is excess androgen, but uterus is normal and the ovaries are present normally. So all the problem, ambiguous external genitalia, this is the effect of androgen, and if late onset, the problem is hirsutism. Okay, other questions? Okay, let's start infertility. The most important syndromes, Mullerian agenesis. This is a female with congenital anomaly. What is it? Absent Mullerian duct. Anything else? Normal. The ovary is normal. No uterus. No upper part of vagina, no cervix. Androgen insensitivity syndrome. Remember the part 3 exam and the breaking bad news that she's XY. She doesn't have ovary, she has gonads that needs to be removed, and later on she will receive HRT. Don't forget congenital adrenal hyperplasia, ambiguous genitalia, enlarged clitoris, fused labia like scrotum, and it's life-threatening. These are the most important ones. And the lab investigation in congenital adrenal hyperplasia is very important. Let's start talking about infertility. We know that if we have two couples, or we have a couple, female and male, 80% of them will have pregnancy in the first year. The remaining 20%, half of them, so additional 10%, will have pregnancy in the second year. So over 2 years, 90% will have pregnancy, provided that they have good general condition, no chronic illness, and they are heterosexual, living together, having regular sexual intercourse, and the age is less than 40. Important numbers. Folic acid, it's routinely given in any woman before pregnancy. We give 400 microgram, except if there is hemoglobinopathy, if there is anti-epileptics, if there is past history of a baby with open neural tube defect, in obesity, And diabetes, we give high dose, 5 mg. Normal semen analysis according to WHO criteria. Normal volume of semen, 1.5 milliliters. pH, alkaline. We need 15 million per milli. And the total sperm in all the sample, we need 39 million total. 39. Total motility, rapid progressive and the non-progressive, 40%. Progressive alone, 32. Vital, 58. So we allow 42 to be dead. Normal form, I need at least 4% to be normal. So 96% teratu is normal. But 97 teratu, no, this is abnormal. This is teratospermia. This number came before in the exam about the abnormal forms. Don't forget, 15 million per milli, 39 million in all the sample, total motility 40%, rapid motility 32, progressive motility, vitality 58. And very important number, we can accept the teratu up to 96%. Don't forget, if we do semen analysis, we find minor abnormality. We can't rely upon it. We need to repeat again after 3 months. What if we have severe abnormality or azoospermia? Repeat as soon as possible. Within a few days, we need to repeat. This is important also for part three. You will have a scenario of infertile couples. And he will tell you that there is azoospermia. What will be the next step? You will say ECSI. No. The next step is to repeat semen analysis as soon as possible to confirm. Ovarian reserve testing. If you are asked, what is the most important determining factor in ovarian reserve? It's age, the most important factor. But what is the normal most important investigation? Ultrasound. Central follicle count. 4 or less, low reserve. 16 or more, high reserve. AMH, 5 or less, 25 or more. FSH, 9 or 4. You can notice that 4 square, it will be 16. 5 square, it will be 25. So the numbers are easy. FSH, 4 and 9. Notice that to have high reserve and you expect good response with your induction, I need antral follicle count to be high, I need AMH to be high, but FSH to be low. Because cases with low FSH, they will give good response when you give gonadotropins. How to test the tubal patency? It depends upon if the woman is high risk or low risk to have tubal disease. How high risk? Previous laparotomy, previous BID. Okay, if there is high risk, we will do laparoscopy and dye. Very important. If low risk, you can do hysterosalpingography or hysterosalpingocontrast ultrasonography. So if you want to choose laparoscopy, if he told you that the patient has past history of BID or previous laparotomy, okay, or recurrent chlamydia, okay, I suspect that the tube is not patent, do laparoscopy and die. What if low risk? Okay, I can do hysterosalpingography. It's more common than ultrasound contrast. Male infertility. If there is hypogonadotrophic, hypogonadism, you can give gonadotrophins. What is the problem in hypogonadotrophic hypogonadism? It's a pituitary or hypothalamic problem. That's why I will give gonadotrophins. What if you find all investigations are normal? It's idiopathic, male infertility, gave nothing. Don't give induction. Don't give clomiphene. Don't give tamoxifen. Don't give gonadotrophins. For idiopathic, don't give don't give hormonal in idiopathic, no benefits. Idiopathic, no hormones. Hormones are important in hypogonadotrophic hypogonadism. And I have such case in my cases with hypogonadotrophic hypogonadism. They gave good response. Don't test for anti-sperm antibodies. No benefit. Don't give cortisone. No evidence. If there are leukocytes in the semen, don't give antibiotic. Why? Presence of leukocytes doesn't mean infection. To say infection, there should be symptoms, testicular pain, testicular heaviness. But only leukocytes, don't give antibiotic. Why? The testis is isolated by the testicular barrier. It will prevent antibiotics from passing inside the testis. That's why don't give antibiotic, except if there is evident clinical bronchitis. What if there is obstructive azo? You can do correction to the obstruction. Reversal of the obstruction. Varicocele. We don't treat varicocele for fertility. No. We treat varicocele if varicocele is symptomatic, testicular pain, testicular heaviness. But for fertility, no. We don't treat varicocele. If there is ejaculatory problem, you can treat it medically. No need for IVF or eggs, no. You can give medical treatment to correct this ejaculatory problem. In female, if there is anovulation, we have WHO anovulatory disorders. Group 1, hypo-hypo. Group 2, normal gonadotrophins. Group 3, hypergonadotrophic. Again, group 1, hypo-hypo. Like what? Like in cases with hypogonadotrophic hypogonadism.
Kallmann syndrome.
Kallmann.
Hypothalamic failure or pituitary failure. Hypo-hypo. How to treat gonadotrophins or pulsatile GnRH. Group 2. Gonadotrophins are normal. This is the commonest form. And 80% of this group 2 is polycystic ovary syndrome. Gonadotrophins are normal. Please, in the exam, don't be deceived by LHFSH ratio. It has nothing to do in the diagnosis of polycystic ovary syndrome. We diagnose polycystic ovary syndrome by Rotterdam criteria. I don't care for LH and FSH ratio. It's just suggesting, but not diagnostic. To diagnose, I need 2 out of 3 in Rotterdam criteria. Polycystic ovary appearance by ultrasound, hyperandrogenism or hyperandrogenemia, and oligoovulation. Number 3, hypergonadotrophic hypogonadism. Hypergonadotrophic, it's a case of premature ovarian failure. You will find that gonadotrophins are high. To treat this case, okay, we can offer adoption because already the ovaries are non-functioning. Or we can use oocyte donation. We can get her oocytes from another woman. So number 1, we treat by gonadotrophins. Number 2, we treat polycystic ovary syndrome. How to treat? Number 1, lifestyle, weight reduction, diet, exercise. Number 2, chromiphene citrate. It's our first line drug. It can be used for 6 months. Okay, then ask yourself a question. Ovulation occurred or not? If ovulation occurred, so in spite of good ovulation, no pregnancy occurred. It's called clomiphene failure. failure to get pregnant. So clomiphene failure is failure to have pregnancy. So the next step will be IVF. Why? This woman became ovulatory, but in spite of this, no pregnancy. So it's not a matter of ovulation. IVF is the next step. If no ovulation, it's clomiphene resistance. So we can try another drug. We can give gonadotropins. We can add metformin to clomiphene, or we can do laparoscopic ovarian drilling. Laparoscopic drilling will be preferred if the case is normal body mass index or even thin patient. They give good response with laparoscopic ovarian drilling. So in clomiphene resistance, we have three options. He will guide you in the exam towards one of them. But clomiphene failure, IVF. Notice IVF, not ICSI. The rule is IVF. ICSI is an exception. ICSI is given if IVF failed due to poor fertilization or severe male factor. It's an indication for ICSI. But the general rule, IVF, not ICSI. Notice that 80% of group 2 is polycystic ovary syndrome. How to diagnose? Rotterdam criteria. Group 1, gonadotropins or balsatile. Which gonadotropins to give? This woman has failure of pituitary. So don't give recombinant FSH. No, give urinary. So it will contain both FSH and LH. Don't give recombinant. You can give urinary because it contains both of them. Don't give purified also. We need FSH and LH, like Minobon or Merionel. Group 2, it's polycystic ovary syndrome, weight reduction, and induction by clomiphene citrate. Clomiphene needs folliculometry at least in the first cycle. Clomiphene needs folliculometry at least in the first cycle. After 6 cycles, we reassess. Is it resistance or failure? Failure to get pregnancy, so ovulation occurred. The options, in failure IVF, in resistance, try another drug, like drilling, or add metformin, or gonadotropins. Gonadotropins must have folliculometry, because hyperstimulation can occur. So, clomiphene citrate needs folliculometry at least the first month. After that, already I know the response, no need for folliculometry. Gonadotropins, every cycle of gonadotropins, you must do folliculometry. What about laparoscopic ovarian drilling? It doesn't need folliculometry. Exam question. Which one doesn't need folliculometry? Drilling. Don't give growth hormone. No evidence to give growth hormone. Okay, don't give GnRH. We give clomiphene citrate. It's our first line. If there is tubal problem, if there is mild tubal disease, you can do tubal surgery. So if there is mild tubal block, it can be treated by surgery, if available, if possible. What if there is proximal tubal obstruction? You can do repeated hysterosalpingography. It will open this obstruction. Or you can do cannulation by hysteroscopy. You insert a small wire, it will open this obstruction. Very important. If there is hydrosalpings, hydrosalpings means that the tube is inflamed and obstructed. There is obstruction. The presence of hydrosalpings equal salpingectomy. The question, do I need to remove both of them or to remove one of them? You will remove the diseased tube only. Again, the diseased tube only. If you remove one, this woman can have spontaneous pregnancy later on. But if both are diseased, okay, remove both, and the next step will be IVF. Again, because I know that there is discussion about this point. One, hydrosalpinx, unilateral salpingectomy, and she can have normal pregnancy later on. Bilateral hydrosalpinx, bilateral salpingectomy, and IVF. Notice, salpingectomy, not something else, excision. Intrauterine adhesion, like Usherman syndrome, I will do hysteroscopic adhesiolysis. Endometriosis, we need laparoscopy. Mild, no problem, but severe endometriosis, we need correction by laparoscopy. Laparoscopic adhesiolysis, any endometriotic spots should be excised. It's better than ablation, excision is better. So you have tissue for biopsy. If there is endometrioma more than 3 centimeter, laparoscopic cystectomy. Laparoscopic cystectomy. The dilemma in the endometrioma. Removal can affect ovarian reserve. No removal can affect the reserve. So we need to discuss with the woman. But the general consensus, endometrioma more than 3 centimeter needs laparoscopic cystectomy. Unexplained infertility for 2 years equal IVF. Don't forget this equation. Unexplained infertility, 2 years equal IVF. Unexplained, everything okay. Tubal patency, ovulation, semen analysis, everything okay. The ultrasound to the uterus, okay. 2 years equal IVF. No induction. Unexplained infertility, 2 years equal IVF. IO induction of ovulation. What if unexplained infertility for 1 year? Common exam question. Ask them to try, continue trying for further 1 year. Notice that if you find a cause, it's not unexplained. Polycystic ovary is a cause. Tubal disease is the cause. But unexplained, everything okay. For 2 years, it equal IVF. When to start investigations for infertility? We start investigations after 1 year of having regular sexual intercourse without contraception between heterosexual couples. In the normal age, but starting from 37, no. We will start at 6 months to investigate. At 1 year. What if a couple came to you in the clinic? They are trying to have pregnancy for 6 months and everything is okay. So general appearance, okay. No chronic disease. The woman is ovulating. Regular cycle. No chronic illness. Okay. Try to have pregnancy until they complete 1 year. If they came at 1 year, no pregnancy occurred yet, then you can start investigations. You can do semen analysis, ultrasound to the uterus, medluteal progesterone to check ovulation, and the tubal patency test, according low risk or high risk. IUI. We have limited indications for IUI. Yes.
Even if the couple of advanced age, yani we have to wait until 1 year.
I said 37 and more start investigation early at 6 months.
Okay.
Limited indications for IUI. We have 4 indications. Number 1, physical disability, that the male can't have erection. Number 2, the male is HIV, and we need to do sperm washing to remove the seminal plasma which containing HIV. Okay, it's an indication. People in same sex, so they are 2 females. Okay, I can do IUI for 1 of them. Number 4, if we want to do semen donation. Limited indications, don't add. Unexplained infertility, we don't use IUI as first line. Unexplained infertility, 2 years IVF. This is NICE guideline. What if they have religious contraindication for IVF? Okay, then we can apply IUI. But this list, it's limited to the indications of IUI. Don't add to them. Okay, IUI with induction or without induction? Without induction, as long as the woman is ovulating. So we don't do induction of ovulation for ovulating women. No, we don't do this. Okay. So let's say that two women came. Okay, they want to have pregnancy. So we will do IUI for one of them. Okay. Do we need to do tubal testing or not? No need. We know that the cause here is clear, that they are homosexual. So we can start IUI for 6 months by donor sperm. What if no pregnancy occurred? Now you can do testing for tubal patency. So no need to start from the start in these situations by tubal patency testing. Because they are not infertile, we know that there is a problem. We know the problem. So start 6 cycles, IUI, without induction, without testing tubal patency. No pregnancy yet, okay. Then I can do testing for tubal patency and continue further 6 months. Now the patient received total 12 cycles, IUI. The next step, IVF. IVF. HCG. HCG is not needed in clomiphene citrate. HCG is needed if you give gonadotrophins. HCG, of course, is needed in IVF and ICSI. But in clomiphene, no, not needed. Using partner or donor, whatever. Yes?
Donor, I can understand. Partner means...
You say how it can be donor, it can be partner sperm.
Yeah, partner.
Like the situation of mental disability.
Same, okay.
We will use partner sperm. Okay, or in cases with HIV, we will use partner sperm IUI. So, total IUI cycles can be offered 12 cycles. What will be the result? 50% will have pregnancy in the first 6 cycles. Additional 25% will have pregnancy in the next 6 cycles. So you are talking about 75% success rate for 12 cycles IUI. It's near to the normal fertility rate. In the first year of marriage, we have 80%. So it's near. 12 months, 12 cycles, 80%, 75%, it's normal. Yes, we don't give induction of ovulation for ovulating women. What if he told you that? The case, the woman is polycystic ovary syndrome, and the male is HIV. We want to do sperm washing. Okay. Now you can do IUI with induction. But if the woman is ovulating, no induction. Already your target is to have one oocyte. So why to give induction? Yes, success rate for one cycle IUI around 10 to 15%. But 12 cycles, success rate will be 75% in these total 12 cycles. But each cycle, 10 to 15. Very important. Already we have part of it before. Mild endometriosis. Please, this slide, you will find a question in the exam from this slide, inshallah. mild endometriosis, mild male factor, or unexplained infertility, no cause can be seen, ask them to try 2 years. They tried 2 years, no pregnancy occurred, IVF. Is the next step. They have religious contraindication for IVF, okay, IUI. Again, unexplained infertility, mild endometriosis, mild male factor. Ask them to try pregnancy for further 2 years. No pregnancy occurred, IVF. Refusing IUI. Very, very important.
Dr. Isana, one question, please.
Yes.
So it is severe endometriosis, go for IVF without waiting for 2 years.
Again, please. Again.
If it is a severe endometriosis, so go for IVF without waiting for 2 years.
Severe endometriosis, you can do laparoscopic adhesiolysis and laparoscopic removal of the endometriosis. If this failed and you are planning for IVF, you can use ultra long protocol that you give GnRH antagonist, okay, or even GnRH agonist 3 months before the IVF cycle. This increases success rate.
Without waiting 2 years.
In severe endometriosis?
Yes.
In severe endometriosis, the woman is already suffering. There is infertility, there is dysmenorrhea, dyspareunia. Do laparoscopy. Try to correct. If corrected, okay. Not corrected, next step will be IVF using the ultra-long protocol. Okay? Okay, so don't forget, mild endometriosis, mild male factor, or unexplained infertility allows them to try for 2 years. No pregnancy, IVF. Refusing IUI. IUI with or without induction? Without induction.
2 years, yeah, from the first marriage?
Look, let's say that they married 2016. They came 2017 asking for fertility. So they have already 1 year. Okay. You will start your investigations. I did everything. I did tubal patency testing. I did midluteal progesterone, tubal testing, ultrasound, semen. These are the 4 basic investigations. Everything normal. It's unexplained infertility. Okay. Allow further 1 year. So they will come 2018. Now they had total 2 years and everything is normal and no pregnancy occurred. So total 2 years, mild endometriosis or mild male factor or unexplained infertility, so IVF. So 2 years total, not 2 years starting from here, no. 2 years total. You got it? Total 2 years. So if they came at 2017, you find mild male factor. And you repeat the test after 3 months, again, it's mild male factor. Okay, try further 1 year. So total 2 years. Okay? Tamam?
Tamam, yes.
Okay.
So mild male factor is up to what count?
Mild male factor. Look, let's say that we want the number, as we said, 15 million per milli. If you find 10 million, it's mild male factor. But if you find 4 million, it's a severe male factor. Actually, I couldn't find up till now a sharp cutoff level between mild and severe. I couldn't find this. Even in the WHO criteria. So it's
not... 6 million count was given and it was considered as, I think, mild male factor.
We consider less than 5 million as severe. Less than 5 million, yes. This is severe male factor. Less than 5 million. Okay, but what about the scenarios in which there is the motility instead of 40%, it's 30%. The count instead of 15 million, it's 10 million. Teratospermia, 96%. Terato. It's combination of mild, minor problems. So I couldn't find sharp cutoff level between mild and severe. So it's your clinical assessment and your clinical judgment, because you are talking about multiple parameters. Okay?
Okay,
okay, thank you. Let's take a break.
Sorry, doctor.
Yes, the last
In mild endometriosis, I will not interfere at all till 2 years. And if not, get pregnant, I will do IVF. But in severe, I can interfere surgically, even and aiming to get pregnant by surgical. And then if not, I do IVF.
Look, endometriosis mainly, it's a clinical plus laparoscopic diagnosis. So already you did laparoscopy, treat. If there is mild or severe, treat. Okay, treating mild can improve the problem. Treating severe can improve the problem. If I treated the severe and no pregnancy occurred, IVF. If mild is treated, okay, try them, allow them further 1 year. So they have total 2 years.
Yes, I understand. But I mean, if this in the question severe endometriosis, the next step for me will be laparoscopy to treat,
laparoscopy,
not
yes.
IVF. Yes.
Laparoscopy. Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
But Dr. Osama, I solved the question here. It mentioned that laparoscopy only succeed, beneficial in treatment of superficial endometriosis affects the success rate.
So, I will ask in
severe, it's only in mild and superficial cases, not in severe. In severe, regarding pain.
Look, we classify endometriosis according into mild, moderate, severe, and there was another one, I think, minimal, according to American Fertility Society. It depends upon ultrasound, severity of adhesions, unilateral or bilateral, the thickness of adhesions. So it's laparoscopic diagnosis, not only clinical. Okay?
And the treatment to doctor will be ablation or excision?
Excision
for
is
the
better. Mind. Excision is better. So you have tissue for histopathology.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Okay. But if you can't do excision, next step ablation. But excision is better. That you have tissue for histopathology. Because you can't confirm except if after histopathology is done.
Okay.
Okay, let's take it. After the break, okay?
Okay.
Okay, thank you.